Welcome to this special edition of the Ultimate Combat Experience. I'm Mike Stidham. What makes it so special? Knockouts. Knockouts all night long. We're going to be taking a look at episode 14 of Greatest Knockouts in UCE. And we haven't even gotten to the halfway point yet. We got so many knockouts, we don't know what to do with them all. So we're going to bring them out to you tonight. We're going to take a look back at a couple guys, some little guys, Oliver Bradstreet and Dan Berry, who those guys had a storied history. They fight each other a couple of times. But in your main event, Kyacey, Uscola, and the Maniac, Ben Fuamano. You don't want to miss that one. It's the Ultimate Combat Experience KO Edition coming right at you. Off with a couple of little guys that just plain didn't like each other. In fact, Tommy Wagner walked around with a bit of a chip on his shoulder for everybody for quite some time, and Dan Berry's one of those guys that said, I'm gonna knock that chip right off that shoulder of yours. Lightweight, check it out.
Welcome back to the Ultimate Combat Experience. If you're just joining us, man, first of all, you're late.
You're late.
Secondly,
you're really late.
It's the third round of three in our main event where Tommy Gunn Wagner, the old guard, is going up against Slammin' Dan Berry, the new guard. Old versus new here. We're going to see who's going to win this thing right here in round three.
Mike, it's been a great fight thus far. These guys, it's been action-packed. You've seen a lot of improvement from Tommy Gunn, and you've seen a lot of competitiveness from Dan Berry. And so I think that this has been a fun fight overall for the fans of UCE.
I think it's been a fun fan for those of you who know the nuances of this game, but I don't really think it's been a really exciting fight. I don't think it's been action-packed. I think it's been a little bit of a chess match rather than a fighting match, because they really haven't opened up except for a few occasions where Slam and Dan Berry did open up and throw some flurries. I really hope this third round that both these guys realize it's close enough on the judges' scorecards. You've got to do something here to win this fight. Well, not to not lose it, but to win it.
Well, this is where we've seen the first and second round not only start but end with Dan Berry in the guard position, and you know, with the takedown. And so, gosh, I don't know, Mike. It's going to be hard to score because he does have the takedowns. Even though he may not be doing a whole bunch, throwing little punches and staying in the position, I don't think if Lonnie stands him up, you got to give it to the guy to take down.
Absolutely, especially when you're the bottom guy isn't trying any submissions. He's using his guard as a defensive tool, but not you doing anything to improve his position or look for a submission. So, absolutely, you got to look toward the guy on top.
I mean, Tommy's throwing a few punches from underneath that have connected, the rib shots, and Dan will step up every now and then and drop an elbow, but nothing that it doesn't look like they're setting anything up, and they're not really landing the big shots that count.
No, it almost looks to me like Dan Berry. He's trying to stall out a win here, you know? I mean, he's stalling, if you would, in wrestling. He's not really trying to finish. That right there, he's really just hanging on.
Yeah, well, you see his face right there. He's trying his hardest to try and get a guillotine, but there's no way that's going to happen with Tommy Gunn over in a half guard. Dan Berry's really wasting a lot of energy right here.
He really is. It looked like Lonnie Foster was just about to step in there. Thought he saw something he didn't like, but he thought maybe Tommy Gunn was in a little bit of trouble, and he looked underneath and saw he was okay, and the fight continues. Now, Slammin' Dan Berry finds himself in unfamiliar territory on the bottom, underneath Tommy Gunn Wagner, looking for an arm lock, attacking the wrong arm. It looks like.
And Dan Berry knows better than that, Mike. So this kid's tired.
He's extremely tired.
He knows better than to attack that near arm like that, and he did it anyways.
Well, this is a tough position right here. Especially for a referee, do you break this one up right here now?
Oh,
finally,
now
Tommy
Gunn
is
bang.
Landing some punches.
Johnny, he's out.
Whoa.
That's it.
Wow.
You gotta be kidding me.
All Tommy Gunn needed to do was get around on top, and
let
you
the
saw
guns
the
go.
Force, man. Wow, look at Tommy Gunn Wagner, really.
And here comes the rain.
As the
just
rain starts,
like a script, man. Yeah, here comes
I'm
the
telling
rain.
You what, man, almost on cue, but he really did some damage there on Dan Berry's face. Tommy Gunn giving him all the props in the world, but he comes away with a huge win right there at the end.
Holy cow, Mike. He came up underneath with two or three big shots that just set this thing apart.
Well, those shots really didn't seem like those uppercuts right there. Man, those things landed. They were on the button. And Lonnie Foster, I think, did a masterful job of refereeing tonight. Great work tonight. But Tommy Gunn Wagner comes away with the big win.
Congrats, Tommy. You separated it tonight. And hey, the old dog, don't count him out.
Who says I'm old guard, man? I'm the new guard still, man. Great job, Tommy Gunn.
Danbury tried to knock that chip off of Tommy Gunn's shoulder. Well, Tommy Gunn knocked Danbury's head right off his shoulders. Now we're going to take a look at Danbury, who's going to get his shot at redemption in another lightweight matchup.
These guys are, we've said it enough times, they're very evenly matched here. But this Danbury, his training, the people he trained with, the crew he's with, they're really big on this kid.
They're really
expect
big
to see big things out of him.
Well, not only big things, they're shooting for the top, Mike. They're shooting to get a match between Danbury and Ollie Bradstreet. But I think, Dan, you got to have to beat Curtis Leishman first.
Let's take small bites, my friend. You're 5'5", 145 pounds. Let's work our way up to the big
you're going to take on the menace, man. You better be damn well prepared.
Better be ready.
Last time I stepped in here was a couple months ago. I lost that one. I fought one time since, won that one. Neither one of them against very strong opponents, so I'm kind of looking, moving up a little bit, and it's who I want to fight, who I want to fight. Mainly ground and pound. I've been working on stand up a little bit. I'm not going to stand by that, really. I like to take them down and pound on their face for a little bit. He's obviously a strong wrestler, so I'm going to have to watch takedowns, and he's got a lot of throws, watch throws, and just hopefully take him down and win it on the ground.
Now, he just said that his opponent that beat him wasn't a very good opponent. He wasn't a very good fighter.
Yeah.
Well, that's kind of strange.
Well, that's kind of strange, but you know what? Maybe it's saying a lot. Maybe it's saying that, hey, you know what, he can recognize that and he knows that he, because I don't think really before he was training. But now he's over here with UCTC training with Phil and some of the boys, and I think he's getting better. He's getting tougher.
Well, Curtis Leishman's a kid that's shown his worth in the ring here at 5'5", 145 pounds. He's a tough kid.
Last time I stepped in, fought a good wrestler. He's a good guy. Took me down to the ground pretty quick, and I was a little scared. Got me on my stomach and got the rear naked hold, choke. Thought I was gonna go out, but I managed to keep through, and I was lucky to come off with a win. For the future, I just like to come and fight. I don't train or anything. I think it's fun to come and to test myself against other guys and see how I do, but see what happens in the future. I had a couple years of wrestling, so I like to get in and I like to do a couple throws. I like to give the crowd a show, and I try to at least slam somebody at least once in a match if I can. But I'm not very good at boxing, but I do all right. I don't know the guy I'm fighting. I haven't learned anything about him, but I'm ready to come in. I've been gone for a couple weeks and haven't been able to fight, so I'm starving for a win, and I don't want to lose.
He mentioned it right there, Johnny Richie. He's always excited when he fights because you can guarantee he's throwing somebody. He's a great thrower.
Well, there hasn't been one fight, Mike, out of the five or six that he's had that he hasn't literally done a hip thrower, a head thrower, a toss, or a slam. I mean, we can expect that in this fight tonight.
Well, Dan Barry's a pretty good wrestler himself, and as he mentioned in his interview there, he's expecting something like that, so not going to give it up quite so easily. Keeping his hips down nice and low makes it very difficult to throw.
Hey, doing a good job using that cage, Mike. You know, getting down and getting that, getting his hands locked behind Curtis Leishman's legs and getting a nice takedown.
Well, you know, and Dan Barry did a nice job of getting him up off the ground and getting a little elevation on that takedown himself here. Now finds himself with the back of Curtis Leishman, and this is where he's dangerous.
Well, this is where he's dangerous, Mike, because he knows how to use his hooks and flatten a guy out, and that's exactly what he's doing.
Obviously.
I mean, you can see Leishman's legs are in the air. They're just dangling there because he's got his hooks in so hard. He's doing a good job.
Dan Barry did a great job, and he's landing some big punches. Just about gave up position there.
That's tight, Mike.
No, he's out, Johnny.
He's out.
Leishman's out. He's unconscious.
It looks like he put his hands up. I thought he was out for sure. He was using his hands to block, but now...
John, he's unconscious
right
there.
He's unconscious. He's tapping.
It's over, my friend.
It's over.
He's taking a little nappy nap
right
here.
Yeah, he's taking a nap. He's out.
He's
that's part of MMA. That's part of the game.
For those of you who haven't seen that before, you get choked, and, you know, I mean, you're okay.
You're okay, at least 10 seconds after.
But slamming Dan Barry did just that. He slammed and choked and got a big win.
Bring on the menace.
Dan Barry not getting the big knockout he was looking for, but he certainly got the choke out that he became famous for. When we come back, we're going to take a look at a little bit of kickboxing. Welcome back to the Ultimate Combat Experience. As promised, we're going to take a look at some kickboxing matches. And this is one of those fights where you just don't judge a book by its cover because you just never know who's going to win. Kava Manu and Mike Killian.
Tim being a little bit Polynesian is like saying you're a little bit pregnant.
I think Kava looks like he's full bred to me, doesn't he?
There's no little bit about it. He's full Polynesian. Brian's me a little bit of Paya LaPali. Talks just like him, acts just like him, and we'll see if he can fight just like him.
Isn't that Paya right there behind him, as a matter of fact?
There he is.
5'10", 180 pounds. He's a kickboxer, comes in as an independent, making his first appearance here at Ultimate Combat. And as he steps through the ropes here tonight, is a man of few words, which makes it kind of tough to get a pre-fight interview and really get into his soul about how he feels tonight.
I hear Paya's a little bit Polynesian as well.
Just a little.
Just want to come here and do what's gonna do, just having fun, and that's it. A lot of running to the punching bag and a lot of spar. I just give the Mike a respect. This looked like a nice guy to me, but I'll do what I'm gonna do. Let's talk and let's find out.
He isn't much of an interview, is
he? No, he isn't. And I'll tell you what, we're going to put the word old aside for these two and just call them more mature fighters. For me, it's nice to see the guys at this stage of life still feel like they can get out there and compete.
No, it's really cool. But you see, his nickname is the Flamethrower. I used to know a bouncer at a gay bar with that same name.
Did you? 6 foot, 178 pounds. I don't think it's the same guy, by the way. Last time we saw Kellen, he actually picked up a victory. It was a hard-fought but short contest. We'll see how it goes tonight, and he knows that from that experience he's gained just a little more experience coming in.
I was doing a lot of this, Johnny, and it was time to just get up and do it and test my skills. I'm getting older, so it's just time to test it out. I do have a little bit more experience. I've been in a few fights. I know this is going to be all new. I have a martial arts discipline, but I don't think that's going to matter tonight. I'm just going to go out there and give it 100%. My opponent looks real tough, and I wish him all the luck in the world. But I think I'm just going to have to be calm and have the mental edge. Just my up game, standing up game is pretty good. I think that's my endurance is the only problem I think I'm going to have. But Kala Manu, I'm coming after you.
And he can rhyme too.
How about that? I think he's got a whole different ball game ahead of him tonight with Kava than he had in his last matchup, however. So we'll see how he handles the pressure here.
You know, two really, really nice guys getting in the ring tonight, though, Tim. These guys are both very soft-spoken guys. Gave each other a bunch of respect. I like to see that in this show a little bit.
And there's a little more respect with the touch of the gloves. And as we saw from Killam, I'm not sure what that is exactly.
He's trying to hypnotize him with that move there.
He's kind of waves his leg out there, and then Kava snaps one on him, and he's got to be careful. There's another one. Look at
Kava, very patient and really getting a lot of hip rotation on those kicks. Ethan Andrews warning him for getting that kick a little low. It looked like it was on the belt line to me, but Kava Manu looks very poised, very composed here, and again, reminiscent a little bit of Paya LaPali, and I think Mike Killen might have his hands full.
I tell you what, Kava's got a little smile on his face, too, and you're right, he's not intimidated at all by anything that's coming from Killen. Killen kind of steps out there. Boy, if he's going to put those kicks out, though, he better put some snap behind him or he's going to get caught.
Yeah, I particularly like the kickboxing shorts that Mike Killen has on there.
Nice.
They're JCPenney specials, I believe.
They had a big sell last week, as a matter of fact. And Kava starts to step in, and again, Ethan's going to call and give him a bit of a warning there.
And again, that didn't look low to me, so this is a tough one to call, and perhaps because the shorts are a little high there, I'm not sure. Maybe it appears that it is. And now Kava Manu's, he says, I'm done with this playing nice, I'm just going to come at you.
And lands a couple of shots. Killing for a couple of seconds there, found himself up against the ropes, which was a bad place to be. And Ethan just wants to come in and give them both a little bit more instruction as we move on into this round.
And so far, Kava Manu has been very much in control of this fight. He's landed all the shots, basically. Mike Killen's going to have to go back to his corner here with 30 seconds left and try to go back to the drawing board.
Well, if he makes it that far, still 27 seconds. And my guess is that if Kava will start off with another one of those combinations and turn it into a flurry, this one could be over in a hurry.
Yeah, Mike Killen looked white when he came in the ring. He looks purple now. And throws a big spinning back fist that just misses. And that could have made an impact on this fight.
And here comes Kava. Might be a little too late in this round to end it, but you can see from the headshots that Killen's tanking him, and now he's not even putting up much of a defense. 1 second left. Talk about saved by the bell. There's that flurry I was talking about a second ago.
That was the big flurry you mentioned. You know, it's unfortunate it was too little too late. You see, he's really breathing hard here. Had he thrown that flurry early in the round, he might have had some behind it, but it seemed like all those punches were very slappy. You see here in your Crush Combat Cam, brought to you by the American Bushwear. A nice exchange of kicks and punches early on, but Kava Manu really poured it on toward the end of the round.
And here's some of that action as he gets Killen up against the ropes. That was mid-round. And then we saw another flurry just like that at the end of the round. And there's a little bit of it there as we get ready to bring in round number two coming up.
No hips behind any of those punches. Again, they were kind of slapping punches, not a lot of power behind it. But, you know, Mike Killen weathered the storm. And he actually looks like he's in a little better condition coming out of the corner than Calvin Manu does. He's really struggling over there.
So maybe it'll be who has the most gas in the tank here as we get ready for round number two. This is kickboxing, scheduled for 2 minutes each round.
And one of the ugliest kicks we've ever seen.
We've seen several of them from Killen here.
Yeah. Oh, a big right hand. Boy, that Killen's got a pretty good chin because that was a nicely thrown punch with a lot of hit behind it, and Killen just kind of brushed it off.
Yeah. Kava's just wailing away here. Oh, but he takes a left hand that sends Kava down.
Walks right into a left hand. I'm not really sure what it was. It was a jab or a hook kind of halfway between the two, but sent Kava Manu to the canvas. And now Kava's going to have to regain his composure and see if he can come back from that.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how he does respond after taking that shot. Killen got a lucky one in there.
And Killen looks like he's still posing for that JCPenney catalog over there.
I don't think he'll make the next catalog, to be honest with you. Now Kava's going to come on and get him. And there's a couple of shots that go right to the chin of Mike Killen.
Knocking Kava Manu down might have been a mistake because now he's got him mad and he's coming back with a vengeance now. But again, he's really breathing hard and not a whole lot behind these punches here.
And I'll tell you what, Kava better get on the inside because as he stands on the outside, Killen's got a bit of a reach advantage on him, and that's both times he's been caught. That's where it's happened.
Well, aside from the one punch, Kava's won this round as well, so I give him round one and a draw here because of the knockdown. So we're going about 30 seconds left here in this second round, and it looks like these guys are really starting to wear down.
Kava struggling now just to maintain his feet and covering up as Mike Killen seems to have a little bit more behind those punches at this point.
You see Kava leaning. He's leaning there. He's out of gas. He doesn't have his legs underneath him anymore. He's leaning in trying to punch, and his legs are not supporting him. He's just too tired, not getting the blood circulating anymore. With 10 seconds left, Ethan Anders is going to wave this off.
Unbelievable. If you would have told me leading into the second round that Kava would quit with 18 seconds left, I would have never guessed it.
I don't think he quit. I think his legs quit on him, and he wasn't able to continue the fight anymore, but you give hats off to Mike Killen. That was the ugliest kick we've ever seen. I've got to get him a award for that. You see here in your Crush Combat Cam, brought to you by Jackson Walter, attorneys at law, where again, Kava Manu was dominating the round, but just couldn't keep his legs beneath him.
Yeah, and as he started to lean, he just walked into several of those punches from Mike Killen. So good news, Killen's got another W. The bad news is he still thinks he can beat up on people, and he'll be back again.
The flamethrower survives to fight another day.
One of these days, it'll catch up to him.
I'm telling you, Mike Killen, hey, wasn't the prettiest thing to watch, but he was a pretty tough guy. When we come back, we're going to take a look at a little bit of snatch. Welcome back to the Ultimate Combat Experience. Before we went to break, I promise you we're going to take a look at a little bit of snatch. And when I say a little snatch, I'm talking about Zach Anderson, pretty tough kid, going up against a kid named Sergio Lopez. And the first round was a bit of a snoozer, so we're going to kick this thing off in the second round.
Welcome back to the Ultimate Combat Experience as we continue the summer tour. Johnny Ritchie, in the interest of time, we're going to skip all the talking and get right to the hit. We got Sergio Lopez and snatch. Zachary Anderson going to slug this thing out in a lightweight matchup.
He better come out swinging.
Well, let's get right into round two with a touch of the gloves. These guys are going to meet at the center of the cage and right back at it just as they did at the first of the fight here. These guys come out swinging.
They came out swinging just almost like the last time, except Zach didn't get the takedown this time. But you saw him attempt one. He went in to grab one. Oh, now he's getting rained on, and Sergio's got some confidence in him right now.
Both these guys are feeling pretty confident. The duck just ducking the heads and going right there. I think. Wow. Snatch
right hand.
Landed a big right hand to the chin. Sergio Lopez knocked him out. And really, Johnny, what a turn of events. He was just about tapped out with a triangle choke and ends up turning around like that. I just told you a minute ago, that's how this sport could go. You turn around in a second.
Congratulations, Zach. Stepped in there and landed the big shot, gets the win.
Hey, baby, all it takes is one, man.
Snatch prevails. We're going to move into the heavyweight division now. Lolo Tuiaki, this guy did a lot of damage, but he's going up against a huge guy in Bryce McMakin. Check it out.
Last time I stepped in here, I wasn't fit. You guys just called me a week in advance. I should bust you up right now. But, I'm a little bit more fit now, and I'm heavier, but I'm going to need it because this guy's real big, so...
I know a few things and I gotta use them. Superior skill and know-how. Beat him with my head.
Boy, let me tell you, Johnny, that Tuiaki looks fit, doesn't he?
That's so funny. I'm more fit, but I'm heavier.
I'm heavier, but I'm more fit.
But I'm more fit.
And then Bryce McMakin is just gonna
use his head. He's gonna outthink him here, I guess.
He realizes this is not a chess match.
Yeah, this is not a chess match. Oh, but there's a couple good shots.
A couple good shots.
It's always fun when the big boys get in here and shake the cage up a little bit.
He ate a couple shots in the process, and he ate a big shot right there. He did use his head, but for the wrong thing.
He's to block
he's
the punch.
Beating the hell out of Tuiaki's fist with his head right there.
Oh, man.
This fight's over, Johnny Ritchie. That one went by fast, and maybe he'll still thinking about his strategy, but... Tuiaki came out looking good.
And fit.
Oh, he is fit. There's no doubt about it. Put that shirt back on.
Lolo Tuiaki doing what Lolo Tuiaki does, and that's beat people up. Now we're going to take a look at a little guy named Oliver Bradstreet going up against Josh Buck. These guys fought a couple of times and both had the same result. Check it out.
Why are you going to walk away the victor, Ollie Bradstreet? What separates you from the competition?
I've got more heart. He obviously had it, but he lost it. I've still got it.
All right. Tell us, what does it mean for you to be walking away with that championship belt? Give us a prediction of tomorrow's fight.
I don't know prediction. Josh is a good fighter, but I'm gonna throw down harder than I ever have before. I hope he steps up. It's going to mean a lot to walk away with that belt to me and my family and everybody who's behind me.
Last time you guys fought and went, it didn't go your way. What's going to be the difference in tomorrow night's fight inside the cage?
I'm not going to give him anything. Last time he got a guillotine, he put me out. Give him credit for that. But this time he's not going to get a hold. He's not going to lock up.
He's not going to lock up. What does it mean for you to walk away with that belt? Give us a prediction about how excited you're going to be tomorrow.
It's going to be awesome walking away with the belt, redeeming a loss, and showing that I still have what it takes to get in with the best and beat him.
Johnny Ritchie, one of the all-time good guys in our show. Josh Buck, he's a great kid.
Well, Mike, he's been around for how long? I mean, he's been a part of the MMA game since I've been around it in Utah.
Well, when we first started this show, he came in as one of the seasoned veterans, guys that had fights, and guys that everybody expected to kind of walk away with this thing, and, you know, he kind of did for a while there. Mm-hmm. But, man, has the competition increased with Little Mac and Ollie and the rest of the bunch.
Well, it's increased with this kid being on top of the game, Mike, for how long now? I mean, the Ollie the Menace Bradstreet, Mike, has done a great job of standing the test of time and beating the toughest guys in the state of Utah and outside of the state for that matter.
I know. Oliver Bradstreet has certainly earned his position up there on the top of list of names of guys that really belong in that category. Man, look how excited he is. He respects Josh Buck, and I think that's why he's so excited right now. He wants to beat a kid, but he knows he's going to have to work to do it.
Oh, yeah, definitely, Mike. You know, we've seen this fight happen once before, but Ollie Bradstreet did come away the winner. You heard Josh Buck say, hey, he caught me. Respect to you, buddy, but it ain't going to happen that way again.
You know, some say a guillotine's kind of a cheesy move, something that, you know, you can get caught in, but it doesn't necessarily mean your opponent's better than you. But, hey, if he saw it coming and get you in it, then he'll take it.
Then I'll take that win any day. But both very aggressive college-level wrestlers, Mike. Both have a pedigree when it comes to submission and wrestling, period.
Really, Oliver has not got that same pedigree in submission. I mean, Josh has been doing it for quite some time, albeit with guys that are bums up there, Ogden Fighting Alliance. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding, man. Throw a little jab in there.
I guess. You see Ollie right there shaking his head. Nah, I think I'm going to get it. Same way, guillotine? No?
No, he's not going to get it. He doesn't have the position for it. And Josh Buck knows that, unless he makes some adjustments here. But, you know, Josh has really been training with some good guys over at Elite now. He's got some really tough training partners, and he was able to get his head
head out there. Now he's kind of in a half mount, half guard position. Oliver Bradstreet, though, look at that reversal.
Whoa, but Josh sticks it out. And now Josh is in full mount, a position that we didn't see before the first time they fought. Ollie could be in some trouble here, Mike, because Josh knows what to do from this position.
He really does. And he's going to push up and punch. And boy, you know, though, the Oliver Bradstreet, he just never stops moving. You can't ever get a gauge on this kid. He never stops moving. Oh, my goodness, though, Johnny. He's stretched out, and he's in a little bit of trouble right here.
Bad news here. Josh is going to try to flatten Ollie, you know, straight belly down and oh, right, wow, just like that. Now,
could this be vindication time here? Josh Buck has waited so long to get back in here and prove that Oliver Bradstreet, it was a fluke. You caught me in that that guillotine, cheesy hold guillotine. And, boy, he's paying. He's turning the tables on him right here. He's really got this thing on. He's got his hips down and giving Oliver Bradstreet fits.
Well, I want to see him be patient with the mic and maybe work a few punches before he gets his submission, because you know Ollie's going to be really good with working his feet and fighting out of legs here.
Oliver doing a good job of getting his hips up high to try to shake Josh Buck off.
But
Josh
Buck's
a college-level wrestler. He's got his legs in tight, and he's got this thing on tight, Johnny.
Mike, this could be over. He could be out from underneath it.
No, he said give him a thumbs up sign there.
He just gave me the thumbs up.
Lonnie Foster can't see his face, so he's asking me, he's okay. Gave him a thumbs up. He's like, heck yeah, this is fun.
I thought he was going to tap, I thought he was going to tap.
Josh Buck got a figure four on the body now. He can squeeze there as well.
Man.
He's got it all on here.
Wow, wow. But look at Ollie, head hunting just like a wrestler does. Looking for it, gonna pull it, shake it.
Wow, Johnny. He was in such a bad position a moment ago, and he's pretty much fought his way out of it. Now he's on top. Unbelievable.
Unbelievable. Wow.
Almost left his arm behind there, but he shook. He dodged a bullet there.
Big forearm. Big elbow.
Yeah, that was a big elbow.
He's going to make him pay a little bit. Elbow.
But he's throwing elbows from within the guard of Josh Buck. Big punches there. Oh, Josh Buck crawling up, and that's... Oh, these are some big punches,
right,
and big
there.
Shots.
Bang, bang. He's got side of his head, inside his ear, back. Oh, my God.
Oh, man, that was a brutal onslaught to finish the end of the round here. And is Josh Buck going to get up here? It looks like he is really shaken down there. And, boy, he dominated that first round until the end there. Oliver Bradstreet, somebody lit a fire on him. I don't think Josh Buck's going to come back out, Johnny.
I think he doesn't know where he's at right now, Mike. I don't know what's going on. They're trying to get him up. You see him blinking his eyes going, I don't know what's going on. He's out of it.
He's not sure what's
going
on.
He's done.
Jeremy Horn's complaining about something here, but Oliver Bradstreet doesn't want to hear it. He says, I beat a tough kid twice, man. I'm getting out of here before they change their mind.
No kidding. Wow. Ollie Bradstreet. He was getting beat.
Oh, you know what, though? He was in a bad position, but Oliver Bradstreet, never say die, give it to him. I would have tapped. See, on your Crush Combat Cam, look at this barrage of punches that he laid on Josh Buck. Are you serious?
He just hammered him. And Josh is
hammered him.
You know, fetal position, covering up. They should have stopped that fight 10 punches ago.
Well, I don't know about that, man. I mean, Josh Buck was curling up, and that fight's definitely over. If he would have stopped it 10 seconds ago, they'd have been complaining about that. But Oliver Bradstreet wins another big fight here in the UCE Finals.
Oliver Bradstreet was just that kind of a menacing guy, man. You just never knew when he was going to be able to come back and do what he did to Josh Buck. When we come back, we're going to take a look at another guy that had to spend a little time here on the UCE, Jarrett Kelton. Welcome back to the Ultimate Combat Experience. As we left to break, we told you we're going to see Jarrett Kelton in one of his many fights here in the Ultimate Combat. This time he's going up against Ruben Flores.
We're going to move right along, like we said, in the interest of time. Jarrett Kelton and Ruben Flores, let's listen to what they had to say before their fight.
It means a lot. My last couple of fights, didn't really get to show everything that I've got. During this championship tournament, I kind of looked at the bracket and kind of see who's ahead of me, and I'm really looking forward to getting to each one of them.
For me to win the belt, it'd mean everything to me. It's like a little boy's dream. I mean, just to win a title. I mean, this is an everyday chance you get. You work hard to get to this point, and if I win the belt at the Depth Center, you'll see a big smile on my face for the next year.
But like I said, this is kind of my time. From day in and day out, what I train to do, to when I get in there, that's just kind of my turn to, like, show what I got.
definitely two of the truly good, good guys in this show, both gentlemen. But Ruben Flores still living in the little boy dreamland.
Yeah, Mike, well, God, you know, he's wanted this thing so long. He's wanted a belt, Mike. He joined the Round of Champions. He got asked to join the Round of Champions because of his heart and because of the way he's fought for us in the past.
Well, did you see right there? He was imagining jelly beans and gumdrops.
Is that what it was?
Yeah.
I was going to say donuts and cake.
Yeah, Jarrett Kelton has got really good kicks, and he's kind of deceiving. You wouldn't think it, but he can get his kicks up there, and Ruben Flores giving up a little bit of height here. Might be in danger of eating a couple of those.
Might be in danger. As long as he keeps his hands up, you know, he is training with Moff and those guys, and we know he does know how to defend himself, and he does know how to drop bombs, Mike.
Well, right there, he didn't defend his legs very well.
Sure, sure.
And that was the one thing he's worried about. He's a boxer, Johnny, and he knew that he had to avoid getting taken down, and right there he gave up his lower body, and really he realizes and admits that he's almost a fish out of water on the ground.
He is, Mike. But once he's on his feet, you know, you got to be careful, because the kid can land some shots and knock you out. You talked about Jarrett Kelton. Oh,
boy.
There's a big jumping
the
right
Superman
hook.
Right hand right there, and Kelton just missing with that. That was a little bit of Ruben Flores' boxing prowess. You saw that he kind of deflected that punch just enough to avoid being hit by it from his back. So very good job by Ruben Flores.
Well, good thing that Ruben Flores is doing too here, Mike, because he's conscious that Kelton's trying to get that full mount on him, and he's putting his leg up there and making it difficult for him to do so. There's only one way to get over that, and that's over that left leg, and he's doing a good job of keeping that thing up in the air so he doesn't get the opportunity to.
Yeah, but it's still defensive, you know, and
sure.
In this game, you want to win, you got to go offensive. And right now, Jarrett Kelton's got plenty of time. You know, as we mentioned in the last fight, we're going to abbreviate this one just a little bit with 15 seconds left. We did cut a little bit of this round off, and boy, an ankle lock here being applied by Jarrett Kelton. Doesn't look like he's going to get it. Maybe he's got a knee lock
over to a knee bar.
With 5 seconds left, can Ruben Flores withstand? Yeah, he's going to make it through this round, Johnny Ritchie.
Oh, Mike, I think one
smiles.
More second.
He looks up with a big smile on his face, says, man, I dodged a bullet there.
He knew it.
He knew that was going on and going on tight.
Wow, yeah, that thing was on tight. One more second, I think he would have tapped, but good for him, Ruben. You withstood it until the bell, and here's the second round.
Yeah, you know, but that's got to give Jarrett Kelton a load of confidence coming into this second round. He knew that he nearly had his opponent, and right there, that Ruben Flores trying to end this fight quickly with a big hook.
Well, he's just praying this thing doesn't go back to the ground, Mike. He knows that he got caught right there. He fought the whole first round off his back, and to end up with the leg lock in the last 5 seconds, he doesn't want that to happen again.
Well, he certainly knew that, you know, that was the adjustment he had to make, and boxers don't like getting kicked in the leg. But he knows he's going to have to knock this kid out. Yeah. Oh, man.
Oh.
We talked about that in the open, that he was susceptible to those kicks, and he ate one.
Oh, he fell right into that, Mike. He dropped his hands, and he ate shin on that one.
Johnny Ritchie, man, I got to tell you, Jarrett Kelton feels pretty good about that. Nothing sweeter. It's like a baseball player when he connects with a home run right there. When you land that big kick to the head, it just feels good.
Oh, it feels great. Yeah, and he is loving it right now, Mike. He gets to move on in this round of champions. One step closer to the Delta Center, one step closer to that belt.
I don't know what it feels like to land one of those kicks, but I sure know what it feels like to take one of them, man. I get a lot of them all the time from my wife.
Jarrett Kelton getting it done. Now we're going to take a look at a couple of good old cowboys. Old Mike Gates, we all know about this kid. He actually moved up to Montana to be a cowboy, but he's fighting a guy right here that did himself a little bull riding before he got into the Ultimate Combat, Sean Hesse.
You thought that one was quick. This one's even quicker. Sean Hesse and Mike Gates.
I like to stand up. I want to put on a show, so I want to stand up and go toe-to-toe with somebody. That's what people like to see.
Last week, I ended my fight in 1:30, knocked him out, so plan to do the same thing, ground and pound.
I just got a lot of heart, a lot of pride, and I'm just ready to go. It's my first one, so I'm chomping at the bit.
Said he likes to go toe-to-toe, Johnny Ritchie, but he's going to go toe-to-ceiling here in a minute.
Mike, just to clear this up, these are not part of our round of champions. These are actually just exhibition matches.
Got to fill on the card.
Fill on the card. We're just putting these in here for the fun of it.
Well, remember he said he won in 30 seconds last week?
Dang.
Well, he won in 8 seconds this week.
There you go, Mike Gates. Wow.
In rodeo, 8 seconds is good, but in mixed martial arts, it's not so good.
It's not so good. Wow, he gets himself another win. The Mike Gates sweepstakes continues, and another knockout.
What are you going to say? How are you going to top that one?
All right, we're over here talking a minute ago, and I heard you say, what happened? I've been there, man. I've been there. How do you feel?
No, it sucks.
Mike Gates
showing that 8 seconds is not good in MMA. It's only good in bull riding. Now we're going to take a look at our main event. A couple guys that, man, in fact, I've been waiting all show for this. The Maniac, Ben Fulmano, and Kyacey Uscola are going to mix it up in a finals match.
I'm ready to rock and roll like I always do. You expect a great fight. It's probably going to end quick, but... You know, all my boys came out. Might be a little disappointed that it ends fast, but sorry, that's the way I do it. Bottom line, I'm the better fighter.
You're right about that part. It's going to end quick, and it's not going to be me going down, boy. Basically, I just picked my training up a notch just for this fight. That belt you won in Antigua, that's supposed to be mine. I'm plain and simple, I'm going to knock this cat out.
He's going to knock him out right there. Oh, I want you guys to shake hands. Benjamin Fuimano, ice cold, Uscola. Best of luck to both these guys in tomorrow's competition.
Boy, Johnny Ritchie, no need to put together a best of episode this time, man, because this show right here, man, you got your money's worth, and send me your donations to the Ultimate Combat because you're getting more than your money's worth here.
Oh, man, I'm telling you, Mike, this is a fight that's been in the making since we went to Antigua. Benjamin Fuimano has been on top of the game here in Utah for how long? A long time. And Kyacey Uscola has been on top of his game in Idaho for how long? And so this was inevitable that these guys were going to meet in no better fashion than here at Border Wars at the Delta Center. Wow, this is going to be a great fight, Mike.
Well, you just got through watching Steve Sharp and Ray Perales mix it up, and this fight is going to be every bit as exciting, I guarantee it. This Uscola kid, as we mentioned in the open, is one cool kid, but Johnny, he's a tough, tough, tough kid.
He is tough, Mike. All aspects of his game. He's good on the ground. He's a college wrestler, but he's more of a submission, a ground and pound, just a tough, tough kid.
Maniac just knocks people out.
Yeah, the best one, too, in the business. We've said it time and time again, but if he puts that right hand in your grill, guess what? Good night.
He really brought a crowd in tonight, too. You can hear them all cheering up to get this kid going. This place is electric right now. The Border Wars has been tight as could be, and Maniac and Ice Cold are here to mix it up to see who will reign supreme between Utah and Idaho.
Oh, man, and Benjamin Fuimano doing a great job of just keeping Kyacey back, dropping the punches, because you know he doesn't want to go to the ground because his ground game isn't the best, Mike, but he's working on it. He's progressively getting better. That
was really a classic mistake by a boxer. He leaned in, he lunged in to throw that short hook and subsequently gave up his hips, which, of course, Ice Cold is going to take full advantage of. You come into me like that and you're going to get your hips taken away and get taken down. Maniac has been training his ground, though. He did. He's learned enough to pull Ice Cold into his guard and work defensively from the ground.
And even though he is on the ground, Mike, if Benjamin catches you with one of those hooks or an uppercut, he still might be able to knock you out. He's got dynamite in those gloves.
Oh, he's got enough power to knock you out from just about anywhere. But Uscola knows position. He knows how to stay out of a trouble spot. And Maniac, bottom line is, Johnny, he's got to get back up on his feet.
Well, you know, Casey's going to control his hips and not let Benjamin get any type of advantage. And you can see that, you know, Benjamin doesn't know a whole lot of submission. He's got his legs crossed, just hoping to squeeze him and maybe get this round over with as soon as possible.
Talk about dynamite in your hands there. Uscola is landing some body shots that you can hear from here. Those things are solid. This kid has some punching power as well.
Well, we saw in Antigua, Mike, if he didn't knock guys out, he submitted him. So, you know, his all-around game is there. Benjamin Fuimano isn't there, but what he doesn't know on the ground, he makes up for it when he's on his feet.
Well, you might notice somebody is absent from our finals this go-round, that being Mafu Fosa, because his nose is still broken from when Kyacey Uscola rearranged his face down there in Antigua in the finals.
In the final bout, he hit Mafu and broke his nose it looked like a couple different places. But they're friends afterwards, Mike. We had a chance to hang out afterwards, and hopefully we'll get the same with these two guys here, Mike, win or lose.
Ice Cold is being very calculated in what he's doing, and I get the sense here that he's just trying to wear Ben Fuimano out. He's putting all his weight on him, making this kid bear his weight as well as his own, and really trying to wear him down, because Ice Cold has got a game plan. He's not just coming out here trying to knock people out quickly. He's looking at the three-round fight.
Well, he is, and right there, you know, he said it was going to end early, but a good thing is we're going to, you know, maybe get to see a second round. I'm not sure, unless he can get a submission. I think Benjamin is tough enough to stay in this position, and it's not really going to affect him that much if you're punching him in.
Gosh, Johnny, though, you know, I saw a couple of arm lock opportunities. Ben Fuimano just isn't experienced enough on the ground. He's just not able to get that. Look how long the arms of Ice Cold Uscola are. Ben Fuimano's pushing him back with his hips, and Ice Cold's reaching over the top and still landed landed punches.
He has landed punches, Mike, and those punches are going to take their toll eventually, you know, when he gets into the later rounds. But as of right now, I think Benjamin is might even be content here because he might be able to catch a little bit of a break, a little bit of a breather, and to look forward into the second round where it's going to start out on their feet.
It's not much of a break when you've got a big kid like Uscola on top of you, Johnny. Easily give that first round to Uscola, but let's see if Benjamin Fuamano can turn things around when we come back. Welcome back to the Ultimate Combat Experience. Right there, you see Ice Cold Uscola and Ben Maniac Fuamano mixing it up here in your main event of the show tonight. And that first round, Johnny Ritchie, was one of those rounds that just wasn't really good for the home team. Ice Cold Uscola dominated that first
round. Well, he did what he had to do, Mike. He knew that if he stands up with Benjamin Fuamano, he's going to get knocked out. Did the smart thing, took him to the ground, did the ground and pound technique all the way till the end. Hats off to Kyacey Uscola. Oh, big kick by old Maniac.
Where did that kick come from? And I don't know that I agree with you, John Ritchie. I've talked a little bit with Uscola. He feels like he's got better hands than Ben Fuamano.
I don't know, Mike. I don't know.
that's a big statement, and that's something you don't want to try to find out, in my opinion.
And you see Benjamin Fuamano recognized, yeah, that was a pretty good shot. Gave him a little nod and said, nice job there, bud.
It was just a jab, but that right hand really rocked Ben Fuamano, and boy, I don't know if this fight's over, Johnny. This fight is over. He's not getting out of that.
Oh, he tapped right there.
He got rocked with a right hand that sent him to the canvas, and he immediately gave up his back, and Ice Cold Uscola is going to send the hometown fans home not very happy tonight.
Wow. I never thought I'd see, well, you know what? He got a shot landed on him, Mike. Benjamin Fuamano, I'd never seen that happen before. Usually he gets taken down and maybe gets submitted, but he ate a shot that forced
Johnny,
him to the ground.
You live by the blap, blap, blap. You lose by the blap, blap. That 1-2 punch of his has been best in the business, but I think it just got bested tonight by Kyacey Ice Cold Uscola.
If I hear you see him hit him, and he gives a little, right there, yeah, nice shot.
That was a jab.
Shot.
It was just a jab.
Right there, wow.
Maniac was nodding over a jab, and then Ice Cold says, you like that? I'll give you my right hand, too, and that thing landed right on the chin. And that's been Maniac's criticism. When he waits, he doesn't perform like he would like to, and he did. He let Uscola throw those punches. He waited for him, and looks like the Primal Tribe Fighting Club is going to take home a big win here, a big upset win from the Ultimate Combat.
Well, Ice Cold Uscola, Tom Supnit, the whole crew up there, congratulations. You guys represented yourselves well. I can't wait to see these guys come back and fight for us again, Mike.
Get back down here, because we got more fighters for you. Great job tonight, Kyacey.
This post-fight interview brought to you by TheOinkShop.com.
Adult novelties.
Kyacey, you brought a lot of friends and family and fans down from Idaho, and you come in here and fight the toughest of the toughest in Benjamin the Maniac Fuamano. You walk away the victor. How do you feel about the whole fight, representing Idaho, and stepping in here and doing this thing?
You know what? It wasn't only me. There was five of us that came down from Idaho. I'm just happy I got the split decision for Idaho.
All right, there. These guys took it 3-2. It was a hard-fought battle. I tell you what, Kyacey Uscola, I know we're gonna see you again. You brought it home in Antigua. You're bringing it home tonight. What can we expect out of Ice Cold in the future?
Big things. I'm going to the top. Nobody's gonna stop me.
Right there, you guys. Mark that words. You got Kyacey Ice Cold Uscola going to the top. Congratulations. You got the cup. Thanks for coming out.
Thanks, buddy. Hey, I want to thank my fans. My fans are the awesomest. My buddies, my fans, family. You guys are all badass. I love you. And all you guys from Utah, MMA is growing, taking over the world. Keep it supporting. You want to take the UCE, you guys got a class act organization. My sponsors, Freak Fight, Ground and Pound. I love you guys. Keep it coming.
That's going to put a wrap on the show for this week's Ultimate Combat KO edition. Kyacey Uscola getting it done. But we're not done with Kyacey Uscola. In fact, next week you're going to see him going up against the murderer, Brandon Melendez. I sure hope you join us for that. I'm Mike Stidham. Thanks for joining us on the Ultimate Combat Experience KO edition.